टोके नाउ,
ठीक है मैडम।
ओके। हैज द टाइम स्टार्टेड? टाइम स्टार्ट हो गया है। एवरीवन, माय नेम इज डॉक्टर सादिया इकबाल। आई एम असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर एट द डाउ यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ हेल्थ साइंसेज इन द मेडिसिन डिपार्टमेंट, ओझा कैंपस। सो टुडे द क्लास दैट वाज असाइन टू मी वाज अबाउट द जीन थेरेपी एंड मेडिकल काउंसलिंग, वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इनोवेटिव टॉपिक्स। एंड आई थिंक दैट एवरी वन ऑफ यू would be interested to know what are the therapies that are going to give benefits to your patient in the practical life at a very advanced level. So let's begin. What is gene therapy? The concept of gene therapy involves transfer of genetic material into the cell or the tissue or the whole organ with the goal of curing a disease, or at least improving the clinical status of the patient, eventually improving the quality of life of the patient. So the researchers are studying gene therapy for a number of diseases: SCID, subacute combined immunodeficiency, hemophilia, Parkinson's, diabetes, and thalassemia. A background of the history: what has so far been done in the field of gene therapy? In the 90s, the concept of gene therapy was actually introduced to the real world. In the 1990, the first approved gene therapy case at the National Institute of Health, UK, was performed on a four-year-old girl named Ashanti De Silva. It was a treatment of subacute combined immunodeficiency syndrome. The defective gene of the patient blood cell was replaced by the functional variant. In the 1990, a sickle cell disease was treated in a mice. In 1999, that of Jesus Gelsinger in gene therapy experiment resulted in a setback to gene therapy researchers in the US. She was on clinical trial for the treatment of liver disease and ornithine transcarboxylase deficiency. This was the enzyme that is used in the metabolism of ammonia, and the patient died of multiple organ failure. The experiment was rendered unsuccessful. It was thought to, the disease is thought to be triggered by a number of immune responses to the adenovirus vector. In the 2006, at the NIH, they successfully treated metastatic melanoma in two patients. In 2017, research scientist ARCH is still ongoing in a number of diseases. So the types of gene therapy: germline gene therapy and the somatic line gene therapy. What is germline gene therapy? The germline gene therapy involves the introduction of the directive gene into the reproductive cells, which are the germ cells. What are the germ cells? Sperm, eggs, or the zygote, with resulting as a result of fertilization of the sperm or the egg, with the objective of creating a beneficial genetic change that is transmitted to the offspring. When the genes are introduced into the reproductive cell, a descendant cell can inherit the gene. So you can save a whole pedigree from disease. That is the most important part. What is somatic line gene therapy? Gene therapy of somatic cell, those not directly related to reproduction, result in change that are not transmitted to offspring. For an example, gene therapy, for example of gene therapy in the somatic cell is the introduction of the gene in an organism or tissue to induce the production of an enzyme. This alteration does not affect the individual genetic makeup as a whole, and it is not transmitted to its descendant. Types of somatic gene therapy: two types, ex vivo and in vivo, cells that are modified outside the body and then transplanted back in again. These are the ex vivo, while the in vivo are the change in the cell when the cell are still in the body, because the gene is transformed to cell inside the body of the patient. So the basic process of gene therapy is like it utilizes the DNA into the cell, which can be accomplished by a number of methods. Two major methods used for the procedure are the viral vector and the non-viral vector. Utilizing the recombinant virus or the naked DNA or DNA complexes, respectively. The viral vector binds to their host and introduces their genetic material into the host cell. The plausible strategy for gene therapy by removing the viral DNA and using the virus as a vehicle to deliver the therapeutic DNA. The viruses used are altered to make them safe, although some risks still do exist with gene therapy. So, the types of viruses, RNA virus vector, the retrovirus, they are among the first viral delivery system to be developed for gene therapy application. The viral RNA contains three essential gene, GAG, POL, and NV, and is flanked by the LTR. These are very advanced terms, and you just need to remember the types of the virus and the classification of the virus. The DNA virus vector, adenovirus, and the adenovirus associated viruses like the herpes simplex virus type 1. So, what are the non-viral vectors? Method of non-viral gene delivery have also been explored using physical, carrier-free gene delivery and chemical approach, synthetic vector-based gene delivery. The physical methods include needle injection, electroporation, gene gun, ultrasound, hydrodynamic delivery. It employs a physical force that permeate and facilitate intracellular gene transfer. By the way, these are all invasive procedures. Chemical methods that enhance the delivery of gene therapy include lipoplexes and polyplexes. The lipoplexes procedure, DNA must be protected from damage and its entry into the cell must be facilitated. Plasmid DNA can be covered with lipid in an organized structure like a missile or a liposome complex with DNA. And this complex is called the lipoplex. While the polyplexes are the complexes of polymer with DNA consisting of cationic polymer, and their production is regulated by an ionic interaction, which is again a chemical interaction. So what basically is happening, this is for the pictorial representation for the clear concept. In the step number one, the cells are removed from the patient. In the step number two, this is a laboratory-based procedure. A virus is altered so that it cannot reproduce. So you are altering the virus, which can be an adenovirus or any other type of virus that we just discussed, in the laboratory so that a viral genome is being prepared to be transferred into the human genome. In the step number three, a gene is inserted into the virus. This is basically the alteration of the viral genome. It is still going to be carried out in the laboratory. In the step number four, the altered virus is mixed with the cells from the patient. So see here, what you see, the interaction of the altered viral genome and the human genome happening. In the step number five, the cells from the patient become genetically altered after the incorporation of the altered viral genome. And then the altered cells are injected back into the patient. The genetically altered cells produce the desired protein or hormone, which was the target for which the whole procedure was being taken into place. So let's move ahead. Okay, this is again the same pictorial representation. I just explained it. So let's talk about the success cases of gene therapy. Leber congenital amaurosis, inherited disease caused by abnormal gene called RPE65. This condition appears at birth or in the first few months of life. How does it work? It uses a harmless virus and enables access to the cell beneath the retina of the patient by using a fine needle and The purpose of using this that it is safe in a fragile tissue, a very fragile tissue, that is the eye tissue, and can improve the vision in a condition previously considered untreatable. All right, this is basically a genetic disease of the eye characterized by congenital blindness. So the gene therapy reduced Parkinson's symptoms as well. Overactive brain region, the subthalamic nucleus, which is considered the mainstay in the pathology of the Parkinson's, should be introduced with gene that produce GABA, gamma aminobutyric acid, which is basically an inhibitory neurotransmitter. And then they could potentially quiet that brain region and alleviate the tremor. So what actually is going on, that you are going to silent down the area that is producing fine resting tremor in Parkinson's. So the quality of life, I think everyone must have seen the Parkinson's patient, how much their quality of life is compromised. So by doing the procedure, yes, they can live a better quality life and will be less dependent on their caregivers. Advantages of gene therapy: give a chance of normal life to born baby with a genetic disease. Give a hope of healthy life to cancer patients. For certain diseases that do not have any cure except gene therapy, it could be life-saving. But what are the disadvantages? Is it a beautiful fact package that it appears to be? There are some hazards with this disease, with this therapy as well. For example, viruses which are being used as a vector for gene therapy may cause toxicity, immune response, or inflammation in the host. Disorder caused by defect in multiple genes cannot be treated, and the cost is really very high. Ethical questions surrounding the gene therapy. So, how can good and bad use of gene therapy be distinguished? This is very important. Always consider the ethical aspects in whatever field of medicine you're dealing with. Who will have access, and should the people be allowed to use gene therapy to enhance basic human traits such as height, intelligence, or athletic ability or not? This is a big, big question mark, because you know this is a very innovative therapy, and if it falls into the wrong hand, it can turn disastrous as well. So this is an article from the New England Journal of Medicine. Gene therapy in patient with transfusion dependent beta thalassemia. We just talked about the disease. It was a successful case, but the research is still going on for further improvisation. The study published in April 2018 concluded that gene therapy with autologous CD34 positive cell transduced with BB305 vector. This is the vector that was used in the procedure, reduced or eliminated the need for long-term red cell transfusion in 22 patients with severe beta thalassemia without serious adverse side effect treated to drug product. What basically beta thalassemia is, it is a disease which usually occurs in offsprings that are the birth product of a consanguineous marriage. And in this disease, the beta globin chains are faulty or defective. And eventually, due to destabilization, they make the body to suffer with repeated episodes of hemolysis. The child becomes anemic, jaundiced, and develops hepatosplenomegaly. Growth becomes compromised. The disease has got four variants, and the situation can turn so much and so advanced that the child's life can turn into a transfusion-dependent disaster. Yet again, the child has to deal with the complications of transfusion as well while struggling with the disease. So this is a revolutionary therapy in terms of the disease aspect. So Another study published in the New England Journal of Medicine, gene therapy in a patient with sickle cell disease. This case report published in 2017 presented a patient with sickle cell disease with a history of numerous vaso-occlusive crises, two episodes of acute chest syndrome, and bilateral hip osteonecrosis. The child received gene therapy with the use of lentiviral gene with the addition of an ant-sickling beta globin gene into autologous hematopoietic stem cell. It was observed that 15 months after treatment, the level of ant-sickling beta globin remained high without recurrence of sickle crisis and with the correction of biological hallmark of disease. So sickle cell anemia is another type of disorder resulting in hemoglobin. It is a type of hemoglobinopathy in which there is oxygen crisis that results in sickling of the RBCs. What actually happens that sickled RBCs get blocked in the microcirculation. When they get blocked in the arteries supplying the chest and the coronary system, they cause acute chest syndrome, pain that is unbearable, vaso-occlusive crisis in the peripheries of the hand and the feet, resulting in digital gangrene, auto-amputation, because when they are going to clog the capillaries, there is not going to be any further vascular supply to the distal tissues. And eventually, because of the lack of the oxygen supply, the tissue is going to get necrosed and gangrenous. Same is the case with the bone. Because of the sickling, the femoral head, basically, and sometimes the disease is so much and so severe that bilateral femoral heads get involved. So what happens that the fragile nature of the femoral head makes it very difficult for the sickled RBCs to reach their destination. So the necrosis starts in the femoral head and the patient starts suffering from the severe excruciating hip pain, which is often bilateral, resulting in avascular necrosis of the hip joint or the femoral head. Hemophilia B gene therapy with a high specific activity factor 9 variant. Again, a very interesting approach, a very interesting disease. We know that hemophilia B, Christmas disease, coagulation factor 9 deficiency, a congenital disorder, or recessive disorder. And in this study, they concluded that sustained therapeutic expression of factor coagulant activity after gene transfer in 10 participants with hemophilia who received the same factor dose, transgene-derived factor coagulant activity enabled the termination of baseline prophylaxis and near elimination of bleeding and factor use. So in hemophilia, what actually happens that due to factor 9 deficiency, the coagulation cascade is not working properly. And in simple word, the blood is unable to clot. Whenever there is a trauma, patient starts to bleed and it is very difficult to stop that bleed. You need to give certain coagulation factors and in particular, that coagulation factor, which is deficient in the patient. So, the patient life becomes, you know, miserable in terms that the patient cannot undergo even minor procedures because of the risk of the bleed. And sometimes the disease is so much and so severe and grave that there is spontaneous bleeding even in the absence of any trauma. I think you must have heard of hemarthrosis, which is the spontaneous bleeding in the synovial joints, which is very classical presentation of hemophilia, undiagnosed hemophilia. And yet again, it causes ankylosis of the joint because recurrent spontaneous bleed causes the obliteration of the synovial cavity, resulting in a deformed joint, which is not able to function properly. Medical genetic counseling is the process by which the patients or the relative at risk of an inherited disorder or maybe carrying a child at risk are advised the consequences and nature of the disorder. the probability of developing or transmitting it, and the options open to them in management and family planning. Is this complex process can be separated into the diagnostic, in which the actual estimation of the risk is analyzed, and the supportive one. So the goals of genetic counseling are to increase the understanding of the genetic disease, discuss the disease management options, explain the risk and benefits of testing, and counseling session focus on giving vital, unbiased information and non-directive assistance in the patient's decision-making process. Special problem encountered in genetic counseling: accurate assessment of genetic risk and the identification of children at risk of genetic disorder. So who should provide genetic counseling? It can be provided by a medical geneticist, or a specialist nurse, or a clinician with particular skills in this area, like an obs-gyne or a pediatrician. The basic references for this presentation were taken from the sites that is visible on your screen. I have added certain other aspects from Current Medicine 2021 as well. So I think this is all about it. If you would like to have any questions, I would be happy to answer them. Yes, there's a question that are there any religious implications of it? Yes, there are religious implications. It is just like the surrogacy, you know, there are religious implications of surrogacy, just as the way, because you are altering a thing which has been destined by the nature. If it is not going to be the way it is, this is basically concerning with the medical ethics. For example, a simple example is that after a period of time, when the therapy becomes successful, maybe the therapy can be utilized in a negative way, and the scientists or the researchers start producing artificial intelligence into the real intelligence, or some type of cloning and, mixing and matching of genetic material, which is really not even ethical and not even allowed in certain religions as well. So every therapy has got a negative aspect, and it should be utilized very cautiously. And ideally speaking, ethical boards should be made to analyze every case and situation, that whether the therapy being used is inconsistent with the ethics of that particular case or not. And is it being utilized for the benefit of mankind to treat a certain aspect of disease or not, to improve the quality of life or not? Is it going to bring a change in the life of the patient or not? So yes, everything has to go through the ethical board, and every decision is going or should be done or should be made on a case-to-case basis. Okay, so everyone is not a candidate for genetic counseling. People who are having the disease, have the family history of disease, or have been diagnosed with a certain type of genetic disease, when they are going into another phase of their life, for example, when they are going to get married, when they are going to get pregnant, and you have that thing in your mind that whether this disease is going to alter the quality of life of that person, or whether that disease is going to be transferred into the offspring. If yes, how are you going to prevent it? If no, then what aspects of gene therapy or the counseling can be done to, take over the situation. For example, if I just quoted the example of thalassemia. So when two people are, first degree family relatives and they are going to go for a marriage, and they both are thalassemic minor. Even in Pakistan, let's talk about Pakistan, we don't have any genetic screening or the concept of genetic screening for diseases. Yet again, then comes a disaster when the baby is born with a disease. So when the parents are going to plan to conceive a baby, they should see a geneticist that we are both thalassemia minor. What are the chances that our baby is going to have the disease? If there are chances, what are the chances of having the disease in the minor aspect or having the disease in the major aspect? What are the chances that we should take to prevent the disease being transferred from the parents into the mother? Can it be stopped? Can it not be stopped? And another important aspect of the question is that if genetic alteration has been done in the parents, say for example, is it going to work for one offspring or is it going to work for every offspring? There are a number of questions. There are a number of questions that can be asked, and but we are not subject specialists. We are not geneticists. This is a very, very scientific topic and a very pertinent topic. We are just going through the highlights of the dynamics of the procedure is really a big aspect, which is covered by geneticists. It is far beyond the scope of this class. So gene therapy, not exactly, not in Pakistan exactly, not in Karachi exactly. There was a news a couple of years back that in Shifa in Islamabad, there is a geneticist who is taking over such cases. But taking over was being done in terms of counseling, not in terms of alteration of any type of genetic material. So, not at present, it is not in practice over here. So, can anyone tell me about? The ethical implications. Can we talk about that? What could be the ethical implications? Anyone? What is the major ethical implication that can be a big question mark? What is Frankenstein monster? What was Frankenstein? Who was Frankenstein? Who or what? I don't know why should I what I should call, but have you heard of Frankenstein monster? Absolutely. Okay, someone just wrote a comment on the chat box, and that is a very intelligent comment. That fact it is a human being who will be affected as a result of the processes in whole life can be impacted because of it. Absolutely. So when you're dealing with such sophisticated technologies, you come across with the situations that are technically very difficult, because it can be taken on the positive side as well, that even creating the intelligence by the use of Absolutely. It was a Prometheus scientific experiment. Eventually, it turned out to be a disaster. So, what I was talking about that, the alteration of genetic material to produce intelligence. Nowadays, in the developed countries, there is a debate or the workup or the preparations are going on for the genetic therapy to be utilized for creating intelligence. We talked about the artificial intelligence in terms of computers and dynamics, but the workup is now being directed in transforming that artificial intelligence into the human intelligence by using the gene therapy. So, are you going to advocate this type of procedure? Are you going to advocate, an artificial human being that is extraordinarily intelligent. And the background reason behind that experiment is going to be the benefit of the mankind, because an intelligent mind can be utilized positively in a number of scientific approaches. So can gene therapy be utilized in creating artificial human intelligence by means of, fusion of, I hope you are understanding what I am trying to say. What is your take on the situation? Yes. This is something, even with the traits of being human, Homo sapien, is artificially created. This is not naturally created. Yet again, there are a number of debates going on, and the work has not been started yet. But yes, there are debates. There are debates that are in view of the procedure being utilized for the development of a artificial into human intelligence form, and there is no limit. I think when once this starts happening, there will be no ending to it. This again is like going to be a disaster for the mankind. That is what is my take on the situation. Everyone is intelligent enough who can go ahead and have a look at what dimensions of this procedure are in being taken into account. And by the way, I would like to put forward a fact that it also depends on your personal uptake on the medical ethics. If you are of the idea, or you are of the background of a particular religion, of a particular mindset, then you're going to put a stop, a bar, or a, period by saying that this therapy should be utilized for the treatment of diseases. There should not be any other implication of this therapy in the name of saving mankind. It should be advocated, it should be utilized only for the treatment of diseases that have already been diagnosed or that are on the procedure of diagnosis, and you are able to save the patient by the implication of this therapy. That, in my opinion, is the only take on this therapy. Otherwise, this can go into, thousands of unfoldings and can turn out into a disaster. Another important point is that when you are creating artificial intelligence into a, transforming an artificial intelligence into a human intelligence aspect, how are you going to manage what you have created? Because that thing, what you have created, is going to be super intelligent. Will you be competent enough, Are you sure of that what you have created is going to be handled safely or not? It is not just about the creation of what is the product. It is also about the utilization, management, and preventing the world from the disaster of what has been created. So this yet again is another important question. And I believe this is a very interesting topic, and I believe that we should go ahead and search in our own perspective that where actually are we standing. Okay, I have a comment. What if that person goes about a different direction than what you predict? Yes, absolutely. That is what I'm talking about. Are we going to numb, kill that being too if he goes about creating a disaster? Absolutely. So starting a thing, starting from point zero, you should have all the dimensions of 1 to 100 and 100 to 1000 that what it can turn into. So I hope that we had a great insight of the topic. And I wish you good luck. Have a safe time. Get yourself vaccinated. And keep practicing standard, social distancing. I hope everything was clear and the lecture was delivered